Good morning. Welcome to Christ Church and our service of worship this morning. I'm David Hall, one of the pastors here at Christ Church. Even though we aren't together physically, we are so thankful for the technology that allows us indeed to worship together. This morning, as we worship wherever you are, we are the church and we are united through God's Holy Spirit. We continue to plan for the reopening of our church whenever that will be. When we do reopen, we plan to have all four of our Sunday morning worship services, as well as a service on Thursday evening, which will have the same sermon as on Sunday. We'll follow the state guidelines, which means that we won't be able to have nurseries or children's programming initially whenever we reopen. And we're going to encourage people who are in that high-risk age bracket, as well as any others who just feel more safe at home, live streaming, to continue to do that. You may have heard us in worship last Sunday telling you that as we make our plans, we've developed a poll for you to fill out and to tell us which service you plan to attend when we reopen, or if you do, in fact, plan to live stream. A number of you have completed that. In fact, some of you did it more than one time. You're finished. Thank you. We appreciate that. Now we'd like the rest of you to please complete that poll. Today's the deadline for doing that. It's on our website. It's on our Facebook page. It's on our church app, so it's easy to get to it. Please, if you haven't taken the poll, do that today. Please also keep in touch with us online. You're going to find interesting content, video classes, prayer requests, daily devotions, lots of things available on our website, our Facebook page, on our church app. You get to all of those things by simply going to our website and signing up to get them regularly. Thank you.
Our God is an awesome God. How many know that God is truly awesome? He's marvelous and he's wonderful. So what I want you to do is just put your hands together and let's worship this awesome God. Come on. Say, our God is
an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. An awesome God. He reigns,
yes, he
from
does.
Heaven above
with wisdom,
love, power. Love. Our God is an awesome
our
God.
God is an
our
awesome God.
God.
Yes.
An awesome God. He reigns.
Your love, oh God. You took away the
sin. You took away the fear in us.
Yes.
Now we're praying that you can deliver us.
Say.
There ain't no stopping us.
No.
Devil, there ain't no blocking us.
No. Come on and clap your hands with us. Like this, y'all. Like that, y'all. Come on.
From Romans chapter 1 verses 1 through 7. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. In the name of the Father,
in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings.
worship the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Hope you'll take out your tablet or smartphone and open the church app and register attendance at this time. Just go to the app. Down at the bottom it says Get Connected, and when you touch that, the second thing on your screen from the top will say Register Attendance. Please do that. If you have a prayer concern, put that in the notes section. If you have any other requests, let us know. As we come to the time of our offering, while you're going online to make your donation or while you're writing your check, we want you to see a very special video this morning. We've got over 40 young persons whom we congratulate on graduating from high school or for college, and we want you to know a little bit more about them. So enjoy this video.
Crying up your face. Just don't turn away. Why are you looking for love? Why are you still searching as if I'm not enough? To where will you go, child? Tell me, where will you run? To where will you run? 'Cause I'll be by your side wherever you fall.
Would you bow with me now in prayer? We come before you today, Almighty God, with a deep sense of awe and gratitude. Your power and knowledge and presence are so vast that we can only imagine how awesome you are. And yet you reach out to us individually. You're in our lives every day, and you hear our prayers. No matter how close or personal our relationship is, there remains a mystery about you, because you are God. You alone, and we honor you and we love you. Thank you for honoring Christ Church by letting us share in your work on this earth. We refer to our part of your work as our ministries, and we ask that you bless our efforts as we seek to love and serve people, sometimes directly and sometimes through other groups you offer to us as partners. Again today, we pray for leaders at all levels of government and the decisions they make as we begin the process of reopening. Help all of us to be wise as we go about doing this, so there's not a resurgence of this virus. We celebrate today these young persons who are graduating from high school and college. We're thankful for your guidance and presence with them, for parents, teachers, coaches, and others you have placed in their lives. We ask your special blessings upon them as they look forward with anticipation to their next chapter, and pray they will continue to grow in their faith and love of you. comfort persons today who mourn and bring healing to those who are ill. Thank you for Nathan Malone, whom you have called and sent as prophet and pastor. Bless him when he comes to preach your word today. And now we pray together wherever we are, as our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. It's so good to be with you again. And what do you believe about God? How would you describe the God you believe in and worship? If somebody came up to you out of the blue and said, "Tell me about this God of yours," what would you say? I'm going to take three Sundays to talk about something we as the church believe about God, and I invite you to think about it for yourself and to talk about it with others. One of the core beliefs we have as the church is that we worship one God who relates to us in three persons, usually referred to as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We call this belief, this understanding of who God is, the Trinity. Karl Barth was a renowned theologian in the last century, and he put it rather simply this way: Trinity is the Christian name for Jesus. I like that. We sing about it in an old hymn that says, "Holy, holy, holy, merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity." And we sing about it in other contemporary Christian songs. You've heard one of those this morning and others. One that says, "I believe in God the Father. I believe in God the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. And it's given me new life." We refer to this as a mystery. One God, three persons. It's hard to explain, but it's foundational to our beliefs. And I believe that it's to be more than just head knowledge. It should be more than just something we would mark on a list of beliefs or a test or repeat in a creed or sing in a song. It really helps us describe who God is, what we believe about God. And more importantly, maybe just as importantly, it helps us know how we're to live our lives, because as we seek to be the people of this God, then we're to live our lives in this way. We're to be this people. So I want to take these three Sundays that will take us to Pentecost Sunday to reflect on this three-in-one God we worship and believe in. Today we'll talk about God the Father. Next Sunday, God the Son, Jesus Christ. And in 2 weeks at Pentecost Sunday, God the Holy Spirit. And what it has to do, what all this has to do with how we live our lives. It all started back in the early church. They had a dilemma. You see, those first disciples of Jesus who became the church, they were the first church, if you will. They were Jewish. And one of the foundational beliefs, if not the foundational belief of the Jewish faith, is that they worship one God. They repeat it every day. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one." But this particular group of Jews here in the first century had come to experience Jesus as God. They heard him claim that for himself, and they came to experience that and to believe that for themselves. John was the last of the gospel writers that, at least that we have recorded in our scriptures, and he wrote toward the end of the first century, some 60 to 70 years after Jesus was here on earth. And the first few lines of his gospel emphasize this claim. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and here it is, and the Word was God. John wanted to make it clear in the very first line of his telling of this story. Jesus did not begin at Bethlehem. He already existed. He existed from the beginning of time as we know it, because Jesus was God. Well, on top of that, as part of this dilemma, these disciples had been given the Holy Spirit. John tells us that Jesus breathed the Spirit on them the night of Easter. And Luke tells us that on the day of Pentecost, this Spirit appeared to them, fell on them, if you will, in a very dramatic and mysterious way. So these first disciples of Jesus and those who came after them affirmed that this Spirit was not just coming from God, this Spirit was and is God. So they had this dilemma. They believed in one God, but they had experienced in Jesus and in this Holy Spirit God, God's full presence. They, back in those times, back in those years, in those centuries, as well as since then, people have read some of those Old Testament passages and noticed the use of plural pronouns in describing God, or in even God talking about God's self. In Genesis 1:27, in one of the creation stories, we read, "Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness." And much later, over in Isaiah, as the prophet is describing this vision he had, in chapter 6, he says, "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" Furthermore, back in that first century, these apostles, these Christians, these who are out telling about Jesus being God, some of them as they're writing to churches, Paul certainly as he wrote to the churches he was relating to there in the first century, he would refer to each of these three persons of the Trinity. The scripture we heard read earlier from Romans, his opening section of the Roman letter, he does that. Father, Son, Spirit. And then there's a verse over in one of his letters to the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians 13:13. There's a verse that some would say is the most quoted verse ever of all time. Now, some would debate that with John 3:16 being right up there at the top. But there are pastors and priests of churches all over the world for many centuries who have repeated this verse, and many of you have heard this verse because of that. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. But even after all these New Testament scriptures were written, the church continued to struggle with how to describe what they believed. Some said that Jesus was as close to being God as you could be without being God. Well, they ended up being labeled as heretics because the church insisted on maintaining this belief that Jesus was fully God. People fought over these issues. They split up over these issues. They made songs that they used to make fun of those who didn't believe like they did about Jesus and about the Holy Spirit, and others to simply state their grounds, stand their ground about what they believed. Some of you may remember singing these words as you grew up in the church. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. It was known as the Gloria Patri, and it came from these early centuries in the church. There were creeds developed. Those weren't developed just out of a desire of some intellectual people or some scholars to get together and come up with a creed. They came out of this need to say to people, here's what we believe. We want to be very clear with what we believe as the church. And so you've heard maybe of the Nicene Creed or certainly of the Apostles' Creed. Both of those focus on, and as you read through them, they're focused on this Trinitarian belief, this understanding that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit all are God. Next Sunday, we'll have an opportunity, maybe. I was thinking about it this morning. Maybe we'll repeat one of those creeds as part of our worship next Sunday. So because we have this mysterious belief in the Trinity, it helps us understand some things about God and what it means to be God's people. As I thought about that this week, I came up with 9 words that to me are evident of what we believe about God because we believe we have this understanding of God as Trinity. So I thought I'll give 3 on each of the 3 Sundays. Here's my trilogy of words for this day. The first one is relationship. Because we believe God is Trinity, even being God is about being in relationship with others. And because part of the essence of God is being in relationship, and we all are created in the image of God, we are created to be in relationship with others. Relationship with God, relationship with other people. As God says in the creation story, it is not good that the man should be alone. So don't ever forget that from the moment you were born, you were meant, you were made for relationship with God, with people. If you don't have that, there's something of who you are, who you were meant to be, that is missing. And because we believe in the Trinity, that God is Trinity, a second word I would offer is giving. At the core of who God is, we find one who gives of their self to others. God is the source of life, so God gives life to others. God gives God's self to the first humans in relationship. God gives God's self to Abraham in covenant relationship. Throughout the Bible, time after time, century after century, God gives God's self away. And because of that, to be the people of this God means that you and I are to be those who are always giving our self away. Giving is at the core of who God is. So as we grow in our relationship, as that relationship with this God deepens, giving becomes a part, a core, a foundation of who we are. My final trilogy of words about God for this day relates to that one. It's the motivation for giving. It is love. I'm not sure who first said it. In fact, I Googled it this week, and there were different names given attributing this quote that I think very much applies here. So I won't mention because it wasn't clear who first said it, but it sums it up very well. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. John 3:16 begins this way: God so loved the world that God gave. Love is the motivation for giving. If you're just focused on yourself, then you want to keep who you are. You want to stay within yourself. You want to keep all you have for yourself. But if you love somebody else, if you care about somebody else, you want to give yourself to them. You want to give what you have to them. And because of what the rest of John 3:16 says, I believe there's a descriptive word we can give to both giving and love that helps us better understand who God is. That word is sacrificial. God's not just about giving. God's about sacrificial giving. God's not just about love. God's about sacrificial love. So because we believe God is Trinity, those who follow this God and seek to represent this God believe that every person is born for relationship. that every person is invited to give of themselves sacrificially, and that every person is loved by God and invited to learn and live this love. Now, there's one other thing that I believe God has invited me. I want to share in these three sermons of this series. Let me give you a little background first. Back in the 1990s, there was much written and discussed among Christians about, rather than using the terms Father, Son, and Holy Spirit so often, that maybe we would use three other terms or titles for God in talking about the Trinity. Those would be Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, or in some cases, Sanctifier. For the most part, that was rejected among scholars and theologians and pastors and folks who talked about those kinds of things. And the reason was that those titles were really just descriptive kind of titles. They were describing God, but in some ways they were limiting to who God is. And it also limited the purpose of each of the persons of the Trinity to just one purpose. God the Father as Creator, God the Son as Redeemer, God the Holy Spirit as Sustainer. What I want to do on these three Sundays and in the three sermons of this series is to talk about how each of those persons of the Trinity are all of those. That God the Father is not just Creator, but also Redeemer and Sustainer, and the same for the other two. So we'll do that over these next three Sundays. Yes, God the Father is Creator, but God's also Redeemer, Sustainer. We'll do that. And again, how does all this affect how we live our lives every day? It's not just about something I believe in my head, but it has to do with how I live my life because I believe these things about God. So our focus for today is on God the Father. We look first at this purpose given that's most commonly given to God the Father, that of Creator. Well, we get that in the opening line of the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the stories go on to tell us about God creating all that's in the heavens and the earth. Sun, moon, and stars, land, plants, animals, people. One of the creeds of the church says, God has created and is creating. And I love that line because as you continue to read in the Bible, it's clear that God didn't stop creating back at what we call the creation story. For instance, when God calls a man named Abram into a covenant relationship, the purpose of that calling, the purpose of seeking relationship with Abraham in this way was to create a new people. There had been no specific people of God. Well, God wanted to create this people who would represent God and help God bless all the people of the earth. God continued to create. Well, as a part of being created in the image of this God, us humans are given the gift of being co-creators. God's given us the ability to create, to be inventive, to be creative, to be able to enjoy the thrill of bringing about something new and different than what used to be. After the tornado, Christ Church sent out several teams of mission teams, work teams, cleanup crews, mostly with chainsaws to saw up those trees that had been twisted and blown down. I got to serve on a few of those teams. They finally said, okay, preacher, come on along. Try to stay out of the way, but you can come along, yes. There was three guys that were the team leaders or the site leaders on the teams in which I served. Damon Riggs, Paul Edmondson, and David Payne. And it was amazing to watch those guys when we would go to the site where we would work that day. Here, this wind of destruction and chaos had come through and left just that, destruction and chaos. And yet, they were able to walk onto each site. I remember, for instance, one day we were at Roger Ferguson's place, and Damon Riggs and Paul Edmondson, walked around the property. They talked to Roger for a little bit, and they assessed what they saw. They talked about options, and then they said, okay, team, here's how we're going to get at this. And it was amazing just to watch that and be a part of that and how creative they were. Well, I believe that creativity comes from this God who has created us. There was another day. David Payne was the site director that day, and when we pulled up to the site, I thought, oh, my goodness, we'll be here all day, and there's no way we're going to get finished. We'll probably be here till dark and still not get finished. Well, David walked around the property, talked to the owner for a little bit, and he said, all right, I've got this ATM, and ATV, and a trailer. And I don't live too far from here, so I'm going to go get that. And a couple of you guys that's got chainsaws, if you can work on this section right here, create a path so that I can get that those vehicles back to the back. And they did that. He did that. We were done by 2:00. I was amazed. But all of that kind of creativity, and people do that in different ways on different levels. People have a gift. Well, I believe that comes from this created God that we worship. And God uses that to help others. God the Father is also a redeemer. When God called Moses at the burning bush to confront Pharaoh about letting God's people go, God uses the language of a redeemer, of a rescuer there. In Exodus 3:7, the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I'm concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them. It's a language of one to rescue, one who will redeem, one who will save. And much later in the Old Testament, when God's people had been carried off into exile, into foreign lands, God didn't leave them there. God again comes to their rescue and gathers them back together again. So if you believe in this God, you will be a person who takes note of people who are in need and are willing to do whatever you can to help them, to rescue them in a sense, to redeem them in a very real sense. That's why we have a variety of mission and outreach ministries here at Christ Church, both locally and around the world. That's why we serve and provide at the Bethlehem Center and help victims of domestic violence through the partnership. That's why we feed children in Haiti and Uganda. That's why we have an AA recovery group and other support groups for people going through a time of struggle. We believe we are to be a people who give of ourselves to redeem others and to receive that when we need that ourselves. And we believe that because of what we believe about our God and who our God is. Finally, God the Father is sustainer. God provides manna and water in the wilderness and a land flowing with milk and honey. God provides commandments and laws to guide us and how to live life at its best and fullest. And those commandments provide lines for us, provide boundaries for us to say, don't do this. If you go there, life won't be at its best and its fullest. God does not just set the people free and then let them go and fend for themselves. God enters into covenant with them, promising to be their God and provide for them and sustain them on their journey. This God we know as Trinity is still our sustainer, providing for us throughout our journey of life. And to be the people of this God is to be those who enter into relationships with others and remain faithful to them in their times of struggle and trial. We hold each other up and we carry each other at times when necessary. We teach and learn from each other so as to grow in our understanding of what it means to be the people of this God and grow in perfecting the love that this God has given to us. This God did not become redeemer and sustainer just when Jesus and the Holy Spirit show up in the first century. No, this God has always filled those roles and many more since the beginning of time. What do you believe about God? I invite you to examine that for yourself and Talk about that among your family, among your friends, among others. Why? Why is that important? Because those beliefs have a lot to do with how you're going to live your life and how you're going to relate to other people. What do you believe about God? Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks that you are our Creator. You have given us life, and you continue to do so. When our love fails you, when we walk away from you, when we want to do our own thing, you seek after us, you redeem us, you rescue us, and you sustain us. You sanctify us. You provide for us and give us all that we need to learn to be your people, to grow in relationship with you and to better understand who you are and therefore who we are to be because we belong to you. Help us to let our beliefs be more than just head knowledge, something we say or write or sing about, but let it be more. Let it be a part of who we are and how we live our lives and how we see and relate to everybody else that you have created. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You are.
Whenever God's word is preached, we always are called to respond in some way. Perhaps today your response is to open your heart to a deeper, closer relationship with Christ. Perhaps you feel a sense of calling to a new ministry or a way to serve. Perhaps you are not yet a Christian and you feel the need to accept Christ into your heart, or are not yet a member of the church and you'd like to join. I would love to help you with that. If you're in that situation, just give me a call. My cell number is 240-0069. I would love to help you join the church, or in fact accept Christ into your heart.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Once again, this week, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, seek to be the people of Christ. Seek to be the people of this God, three in one. The love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.